The book of Acts is a bridge book from the Gospels to the rest of the New Testament. The book of Acts. Jesus said, I'm going to send you a comforter. I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. Jesus went up. The Holy Spirit came down. The disciples went out and the lost came in. That is the strategy of the church. Let me say it again. Jesus went up. The Holy Spirit came down. The disciples went out and the lost came in. The church, you're talking about fire, was and is on fire. They were waiting for the Holy Spirit after Christ ascended. And in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, the Bible says you will receive power. The word power is dunamis. We get the word dynamite from it. You remember Good Times, 45 and over. Jimmy J.J. Walker, I love that guy. He would do like this, dynamite. That's what it means. You will receive dynamite, the literal presence, the Spirit of God. The Holy Spirit is God, the Bible says. The Holy Spirit is a divine being. The Holy Spirit has a mind, emotions, and will. The Holy Spirit comes into our lives the moment we ask Christ to infiltrate our lives. And the Holy Spirit works from the inside out to produce supernatural fruits. He gives us unique gifts. So we have the indwelling, don't miss this. We have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit that starts at salvation. We have the filling as we're sanctified. And at various times in our lives, we're filled by the power of the Holy Spirit to do this or say that. So the Holy Spirit is coexistent and co-eternal with the Father. Three in one, one in three. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. We can't understand it. There's a lot of things about God we cannot understand. No one can understand the Trinity. And there are people, and there have been people who are 10 times smarter than you who have grappled with this, and they still don't get it. The best illustration of the Trinity is take a piece of key lime pie. Oh, no, just take a whole pie. I love key lime pie. The real deal, key lime pie. Take the whole key lime pie and slice it into three pieces. Well, the three pieces are separate, but they're still part of the pie. That's the Trinity. That's as good as I can do. Are you feeling me? Are you working with me? The Apostle Paul, man, hated Christians. He killed Christians. He was brutal. He was saved on that Damascus road. I'm talking about the Apostle Paul. He went after the church. Yet he did a 180 and became the man of the church. His salvation experience, the sea change, was absolutely supernatural. So Paul goes out on three missionary journeys and he starts all of these churches. Then he decides to write letters to the church. That's a part of the New Testament. You'll see letters written to churches. Then he writes letters to his squad, to his posse, to his homies, to his buddies, whatever you want to say. Timothy, Philemon, Titus. Then he writes the book of Romans. The book of Romans is the Magna Carta of Christianity. Did you hear that? It's the Magna Carta of Christianity. What's it about? Scripture alone. Christ alone, faith alone, grace alone, to the glory of God alone. I just summarized Paul's writings. I just gave you just the quick flyover of that. There are other authors in the New Testament. Simon Peter, major type A personality. He was all over the place. But he became one of the most courageous people of all time. James, John, we move on and on through the New Testament. So you have the Holy Spirit. You've got the church. You've got the letters. And speaking of the church began, if you want to know when the church began in the book of Acts. It began right there when the Holy Spirit came down. Simon Peter preached. 3,000 people were saved. 3,000 were baptized on that day. Now and then people will say, hey, Ed, I really like Fellowship Church, but it's just so big. I go, well, you're not going to like heaven. Because heaven's going to be a big place. And you'll find out as you read the New Testament, the only thing that Jesus ever built was the church. There are a lot of good things out there that we can get involved in, all sorts of projects, all sorts of political movements, all sorts of things. And that's great. Rah, rah, rah. All those things, as good as they are, they're not the church. That's why I have given my life to building the church. Christ's followers want to build the church. Christ's followers are about the church. It's the bride of Christ. Now, husbands, work with me for a second. Can you imagine if you just saw your wife once every 6 weeks? Can you imagine if you didn't spend any money on your bride? I don't think that would work that well, do you? Yet I meet people all the time, oh, I'm a follower of Christ. Really, really, really. Where are you in church? I remember that series, Ed, you did, and I'm thinking that was 4 months ago, my man. So you're telling me you think because you prayed a little prayer that you're going to spend eternity in your mansion in heaven, but you won't spend at least one Sunday a week in God's house? Math doesn't work, does it? So the New Testament is about the church, and it's about the bride of Christ, the church. It's about you and me because we are the church, and it talks about the implications of it.